Okay. All right, so, so we're going to open up here. This is going to be, again, if you get the chance, Vinnie will have the books in this week. If you need a book, I also have, I'm going to have some copies of the first couple of chapters so you can get started with it. What we're going to be doing is we're going to be studying the history of the church, essentially what's called from Pentecost to present. We're going to look a little bit before Pentecost as well, because we want to look into the scriptures, we want to look into things that Christ himself has said, and we also going to be looking into some of the historical and cultural things that were going on at the time. But as we get into it, I just want to talk about some of the reasons why we study church history. You know, it's funny because to me, and everybody's made up differently. So many people say, oh, history, oh, they used to hate history and church in school, and history is such a boring subject. And I used to love history. I used to eat it up like candy. But you know, everybody's kind of wired differently. So just to get an idea of why we do it, why do we care about church history? When, as I was considering this, I was thinking of there was a mini series on, I think it was a couple of years ago, on the History Channel, and it was a mini series on American history, and it was called The Story of Us. Anybody remember that one? The History Channel was called. Anyway, it was a mini-series on the history of America. It's called The Story of Us. And that's the way I see this. I mean, as we're gathered here, this is our story. This is our heritage. You know, I mean, we all come from different places around the country. We come from different countries. We come from different cultures and languages. But the one thing we all have in common here is we are all members of God's church. And that would be true even if, you know, number one, for the people that we have taken this online that are in different so-called churches, we're still part of the same church. And this is our history. And it's important for us to know where we came from. And the things that were important, particularly as we look tonight, we're going to be looking at the foundations. First things that happen in the church. So it's important for us, just as in American history, we look back to the Revolution, we look to the contents of the Constitution to tell us who we are, what it is that we believe, what it is that we hold most dear in this country. You know, it should be contained in the documents such as the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution. So we look to these things to understand where we came from, what we are, what's important to us, or what should be important to us. It's also a lesson to us, as I think Teddy Roosevelt said, or at least I think he was the first one to take credit for it anyway, that if we fail to learn the lessons of history, we are doomed to repeat them. You know, and as we're going to see, as we study church history, there were moments of light. There were moments of God's hand. There were glimpses of, you know, things being done the right way. But for the most part, the lessons of church history are negative lessons. You know, where did we go wrong? What did we do improperly? How did we end up over here? How did we end up in this place? It is just a, I don't mean that in a negative sense, because it is why it's important for us. And the thing that I love about studying church history is to see, in the midst of some of the darkest times in church history, that God always had a remnant. God always had some kind of plan going on. Sometimes it was in the background, sometimes it was in the forefront. Sometimes it was just some little movement that was just sort of holding on by its fingernails, just trying to hold on to what is true, or what should be true about God's church. So this is some of the reasons why it's important for us to study church history. And it's important for us to understand that Christianity is a historical faith. It's not just a philosophy or an ideology. You know, we just got done teaching world religions, and we found that a lot of those religions, the majority of those religions, were started by somebody who looked around and said, I don't like the way things are. I don't like the way things are. I think it should be done differently. No, thanks. I think things should be looked at differently. I think that there needs to be a new philosophy on life and on the afterlife or whatever it is. And somebody just sat down and decided to create a new philosophy, or they decided to share their particular viewpoint, their angle on existence, etc., etc. That's how the majority of religions started, or by some miraculous event. Somebody was visited by an angel, or by some vision. Christianity just is something that came out of history and can be traced, really, all the way back to the beginning. Can be traced all the way back to Adam and Eve. And it grew out of historical events. You know, we look through the history of the Bible, and we're not afraid to look at extra-biblical historical things because we find that they always line up with the Bible. So, there are events in history that for years scholars said, oh, that didn't happen, that were in the Bible. Historical scholars said, that didn't happen, there was no such thing, that never happened. And the Bible says it happened. And then years later, we find out one of the examples is the Bible talks about King Belshazzar. After King Nebuchadnezzar came to King Belshazzar. And historical records say, no, the king that came after Nebuchadnezzar was Nabonidus. And there was no record of any Belshazzar. No such king as King Belshazzar. For centuries, the historians said there's no such thing. The Bible's wrong, there is no Belshazzar. Well, in the 1960s, they found it was like a cylinder, a stone cylinder with writing on it. And they read the writing on it, and on it was information that revealed that Nabonidus had a son named Belshazzar. And Nabonidus spent most of his time outside of Babylon, and left his son as regent in charge of Babylon. And this is just an example of how, you know, we're not afraid of history. We're not afraid that history is not going to bear out what the Bible says, because the Bible is a historic, it is not a history book, but when it says something that is historical, it's accurate. And our faith is a historical faith. It didn't just pop into somebody's mind and somebody decided to come up with it. You know, somebody's personal philosophy. This is something that was delivered by God to men all throughout history. And while we're not going to be studying the history of the Old Testament, that'll be for another class, we can know that all took place to form the Judaism out of which Christianity developed, you could say. From our perspective, from the biblical perspective, Christianity is really the natural progression of Judaism. That Judaism was supposed to evolve, if you will, or change into Christianity, with the Jews and then holding on to their traditions and their religion, as opposed to taking the words of Christ and moving on. So, Christianity is a historical faith, and that's why it's important for us to look at the history. It's also historical as we go through, because Christianity was not something that was just written down. We have it all here in the New Testament, but the New Testament is not a book of, okay, here's how you build a church. This is what you do. You set up X number of elders, you set up a pastor, you do this, here are your doctrines, A, B, C, D, here are your practices. It just wasn't laid out that way. God didn't delineate specific things in that fashion, and there were things that had to be sort of developed by the leading of the Holy Spirit over the course of time. And some of these doctrines didn't really develop and become fully developed, if you will, until centuries later. And some things, because of the nature of history, were not really even completely understood until the 20th century. You know, people often claim, for example, that, oh, the rapture is a 20th century invention, or a late 19th century invention. Nobody ever talked about the rapture. There's nothing, you know, none of the other church fathers or anything ever talked about the rapture. You know, they didn't call it as such, but they talked about the return of Christ. They talked about the church being taken, but a lot of eschatology sort of got shelved after the fall of Israel. Israel ceased to exist, particularly hundreds of years later, hundreds and hundreds, centuries of years later, millennium later, still no Israel. Church scholars scratch their heads and say, wait a minute, I'm going to read Revelation saying all this stuff about Jerusalem and about Israel, and there is no Israel. You know, it would be like, you know, us today having some kind of a prophecy about Machu Picchu, you know. Or the Mayans. Okay, the Mayans are going to come back. The Mayans are gone. They're extinct, you know, as a race of people. You know, Machu Picchu is an ancient ruin. There's nothing going on there, and that was their mindset was there's no Israel. There's no such thing as Israel. It's gone. It's an ancient culture that doesn't exist anymore. So we have to reinvent these doctrines, and we're going to have to figure these doctrines out. And they played with some of these things. Some of them just put it on the shelf and didn't bother with it. Some of them came out with some, you know, some weird stuff like replacement theology and things. And then Israel returned. And then it was like, oh, now these things start to make sense. So, you know, a lot of stuff just developed over time. So that's why it's important for us to see some of these developments. Some of these doctrines that we believe today were doctrines that were you know, put to the test over the course of time. You know, a lot of the criticisms about things like the scripture and about certain doctrines is they say, oh, they met in a meeting and they invented it one day. No, these meetings, when we start learning about the councils, all these, particularly the Council of Nicaea and the different councils of Carthage and Constantinople and all these different councils that came together, many of them sat down to say, well, we need to sit down and talk about what we believe. And not just invent what we believe, but what it is that's been kept throughout history. What has been the historical record? What have people been believing in, you know, up until now? And what do we know? And what they did is they did like what we did. We want to know, how do we interpret this thing in the Constitution? Well, the best thing to do, that's one of the things that they do, is they look at the Federalist Papers. You want to interpret the Constitution, one of the best places to go is the Federalist Papers, because the Federalist Papers were documents that were written right after the Constitution was written. Much of them by men who were instrumental in writing the Constitution to say, this is what we meant by that. Or looking at some of the early rulings of the Supreme Court, the early rulings of the legislature, in their reflection of what they had just written as a Constitution. The best way to know what was on somebody's mind in a particular moment is to see what they did right after that moment. You know? So that's what these councils did. They would get together and they would look at documents, they would look at history and say, you know, what were they saying right after this time? What was the pattern that was going on? So that's why it's really important for us to study these things and understand why, you know, how we've arrived at this organization that we have today. One thing I want to make sure that we understand is that church history is not ecclesiology. Okay? Ecclesiology is the study of the church. That is a biblical, we find ecclesiology in the Bible, and really no place else. We can only study what the church is, the doctrine of the church, if you will, from the scriptures themselves. And that's just what the church is supposed to be, what the church function is, the design of the church, the, you know, the purpose of the church, and all those kinds of things. That's ecclesiology. That's really not what we're doing. We're going to be getting into some ecclesiology as we, as I said, ecclesiology is one of those doctrines that developed over time. So we're going to talk about ecclesiology at some level. But that's not what this is. This is, we're going to be stepping outside of the Bible in order to study church history, because the Bible was completed in 96 AD. And the church went on long after that. So we've got to look at historical documents and things like that. And that's another thing too, important for us to remember, is to understand how history works. You know, we like to think that history is an exact science, but it's not. You cannot prove something in history scientifically. A scientific method requires you to repeat it. Obviously, we can't repeat things that happen in history. History is discovered through investigation, through an examination of the evidence. You look at documents, you look at, sometimes it's just people's journals and things like that. What people were writing, people's personal notes, what people were teaching. And you do an investigation, it's like a puzzle. You want to kind of put things together and see how things match up. And that's why some things are not exact. And the further back you go, the less exact it's going to be. We're going to see certain dates that are going to be like, well, somewhere, that's why they use that word circa, you know. They give a date, circa 96 AD, around 96 AD, you know, somewhere in that vicinity. We're not exactly sure. You know, they really don't even know the exact year that Jesus was born. You know, they say probably somewhere between 3 and 5 BC. Mm-hmm. You know, but still not exactly, because the guy who did it for the Pope one day, he was using a wrong calendar, and you know, when he started the calendar that we use, the Gregorian calendar we use today, he misread some calculation. He was off by about somewhere between 3 to 5 years. So we're going to come across stuff like that. Don't let that shake you. This is history. Again, this is not biblical truth. You know, so some things are going to be, and then even some perspectives are going to be different. You know, we're going to talk about some men that you're going to hear some bad stuff about. And you may have somebody else in your, you know, who's a Christian say, no, he was a great man. Well, you know, history is always told by the victors. You know, history is someone's record of what happened. When we study history, we're technically not studying what happened. We're studying somebody's record of what happened. The best way to do it is to study everybody's record and try to come up with some kind of a composite of everything and take a look at it. And take everything with a grain of salt. You know, with a few exceptions in history, like, you know, Mussolini and Hitler and men like that, most of the evil guys we study in history were not necessarily so evil. They just had a different, you know, perspective on things. I mean, you know, look, Napoleon is considered an evil guy, but he wasn't considered evil by those who support him. You know, I mean, the French loved Napoleon. You know, he was a great emperor. You know, but, you know, we're going to find guys in church history that some people are going to praise and some people are going to boo and hiss. So we're going to try to present it as clearly as we can. First thing we're going to do is define the church. What is the church? Well, in the Bible, we use the word those far away can read it. Ecclesia. Okay? It comes from two words. Okay, ek out and kaleo is the actual word, but ecclesia is called, the called out ones. The important thing is that the church are, I think I know how to say this grammatically correct. The church is a people. The church are people. I don't know how you would say that, but the church is not a building. The church is not an institution. It's not an organization. The church is people. It's the called out ones, not the called out organization. And that's very important for us to remember. We use the word church. It is sort of carried down from this word. Two words. Kurikon Doma. Kurikon Doma, this means the Lord. This is the K, by the way, in case you're not sure. Doma is, we get the word like domicile, house, place where you live. But a doma in the Greek was actually, if you look in the New Testament, it's where you see the word housetops. It talks about declaring things from the housetops. Because the housetops, back in that day, was what we call camp here, especially in Florida. That's a common word. Common area, maintenance, common area. What does CAM stand for? Come on, Mr. Well, you were like a president of an HOA, weren't you?
Community Association Manager.
No, it's CAM. It's like community area something. Because a common area something. Because the rooftops were common area. It was a place where people would gather on the rooftops. So it was sort of a public area. It wasn't their private home. It was an area where people would gather together. Many families would gather together on the rooftops. And Kurikon means of the Lord. So this was like the house of the Lord. Okay? From Kurikon, it came down all the way to German, to just being Kirk. And then derived into the English down to church. That's where we get the word church from. But in the New Testament, anywhere you see the word church, you're going to see this word in the Greek, ecclesia. Now, there is a difference, because there is another word in the Greek. Synagogue. Synagogue in the Greek is, you get the word synagogue. Okay? Very similar in meaning. Okay? Soon means together. And agoge means to gather. Okay? Now, both of these were going on in Israel and Palestine, if you will, at the time. The ecclesia, it was not some holy word invented for the Bible for just the church. The ecclesia, the called out ones, was like the town committee. It was those in the city, in the town, that were called together to put together their not necessarily their government, but their local policies and things like that. It was sort of like a town council. The synagogue was the place where the Jews met. And while the implication is very similar, the important thing is that this represented a break. That originally the Christians were meeting in the synagogue. You know, but it's interesting that when Jesus said, I will build my church, he didn't say, I will build my synagogue. He said, I will build my ecclesia. I will build my called out ones. And the emphasis is also, if you think about it, the emphasis on synagogue is in the people. Is in the people that are gathered together. Whereas the way I see it, ecclesia, the called out ones, the emphasis is on who's doing the calling. Who called them? If they're called out, somebody called them. So this represents a break from the Jewish faith, which is a very important break that needed to be made as the church progressed. So that's just a look at just the terminology for the church. We also want to, when we talk about the church, there's like, we talk about church in three ways. Okay? There's sort of the big church and the little church. The big church with the big C and church with the little C. Okay? Church with the little C is this. What we're in right now. Okay? Calvary Chapel Church. Okay? We are a local expression, local assembly. Okay? Of believers. That's on the small level, on the local level. We are a church, and it's not just about the building. You know, I'm not saying that this is the Calvary Chapel Church building. Us as a believers, us that we meet in the other room over there every Sunday and Wednesday, and even here, we are meeting as a church, as a group of called out ones. But we also look at Church of Jesus Christ at large, which means the body of believers that are living on the earth today. You know, some of them are in the churches around us, some of them are in the churches all over the world, some are not in churches. Not everybody in those churches are part of the Church of Christ at large. You know, I'd venture to say that there are people that come every Sunday and are part of this church that are not part of this church. This is the body of believers existing on the earth at any given time. That's the church. Church in the world at the moment. And then on a larger scale is just what we can just call the worldwide church throughout history. You know, from the time of the apostles until now, you know, when the scriptures talks about, Jesus talks about his bride, he's talking about his church from the apostles until the day he returns. That body of believers, like we're living in right now, we talk about we're living in the church age, from the time of Pentecost on, that is considered the church. The other thing we have to remember that while the church is a divine institution, for sure, it's also a very human institution. And we're going to find out, you know, as we go through history, we're going to see the humanity sort of oozing out. And I'll tell you, we see the humanity oozing out sometimes here. You know, it's a messy thing. You know, anybody who's been in ministry full time learns a lesson that ministry is great except for the people. It's just a joke. It's one of those pastoral jokes. but the church is full of people. You know, remember the old?
Yeah.
Full of people. The church is full of sinful, wicked, fallen people, selfish people, you know. One of the purposes of the church is to try to help work some of that out through the power of the Holy Spirit, through the Word, you know, cleansing process to work some of that stuff out, but in the process of it being worked out, it leaks out. And things happen in churches that are not nice. I mean, how many here have been through a church split? I've been through a couple. They're not nice. They're ugly. People who once loved each other, people who once looked at each other and hugged each other and kissed each other and said, "You're my brother," you know, are now looking at one another like they're evil. And it's a shame. And we're going to see that through history, the church has done some not so nice things on a global scale. there's a song by Casting Crowns called Wedding Day. And it paints a really neat picture of the church, but it has a line in there, and it says, "Calls the church a worn and weary maiden who bears the shame of history." Because when we look back on the history of the church, there's a lot to be thankful for. There are amazing things to see the hand of God. To me, it's a miracle that the church exists today. It's only a divine movement that keeps the church in existence today. Because if it were up, it's like in the words of Gamaliel in the book of Acts, leave them alone. If they're of God, you won't be able to stop them. If they're not of God, they'll fail on their own. It's of God, yeah. And he said, if they're of God, you won't be able to stop them, and you're going to find yourself fighting God. You know, the church has been held together by divine power. Because of the things that have happened throughout history, you can see any other religious institution that had been through kind of things that the Christian church has been through would have long since crumbled and faded. You know, so it's important for us to get a proper perspective of the church, that we don't get too, you know, I mean, sometimes when we study American history, we get, you know, our chest gets out, maybe not in the last few years, but, you know, but as we, you know, as we study, there are certainly some things, there are scars in American history that we're not proud of, but for the most part, we kind of say, well, look, we did the right thing, we made it through, we fought certain wars, we came in, we defeated Hitler, we kind of start sticking our chest out. You study church history, and there's not a lot to be, like, posturing and, you know, getting all proud about. The thing you can be amazed at is how God has kept it together. So, as we go through church history, we're going to look at, there's some branches within church history that we're going to, that are going to sort of rear its head. It's not anything that happens progressively. It's not anything that happens with any kind of rhyme or reason. But as we go through, it gets dealt with as it sort of comes up. And you know, these branches that we're going to look at, just so we can maybe remember them, they all start with P. Starts with political. Okay. And what that means is church and state. We're going to find that as we go through church history, this is a very, very important factor that comes up. Particularly, well, even from the beginning, whether it's animosity between church and state, or collusion within church and state. You know, either the two are at each other's throats, or there's too much overlap going on. The relationship between church and state is always a very tenuous thing. And through history, we see that it is a pattern that we're still even, you know, watching today. It's a very, very, very tenuous relationship. The next one is propagation. Okay. And by that, I mean, you know, missions, carrying out the gospel. This is things that we're going to see throughout history in different times. We're going to see a lot of missions right at the very beginning. We're going to go through a period of time where there's not much missions going on at all. And then it comes back and then resurgence in later years. And we're just going to kind of see how the church through the years deals with this idea of propagating itself by carrying out the gospel. Persecution plays a very important factor. Starting off with Jewish persecution in the very beginning. They were persecuted by the Jewish authorities, then they were persecuted by Roman authorities. In time, there was persecution through, as the Muslims began taking over the world. One of the things that the Muslims would do when they would take over, for example, when they took, it was one thing when they took over a lot of Northern Africa and the Middle East, but as they started working their way into Europe, particularly as, you know, you may or may not know that Spain was really a Muslim country until about the 1500s. And you had a choice. You either became a Muslim. You could stay a Christian if you wanted, but you had to pay a tax. And you were considered a second class, you were not considered a citizen at all, but considered a second class citizen, if you will. You had no rights. You know, people could persecute you, could beat you, could arrest you, could do whatever they wanted to you. So there was persecution that went on from Muslims as they were taking over various areas of geography. And then we see persecution still going on today. We see persecution going on in the 20th century. It's been said that more Christians have been martyred in the 20th century than were martyred in all the previous centuries combined. You know, you read trying to get his magazine now, Voice of the Martyrs by Richard Warmbrand, some of his books, Torture for Christ. That what Christ would you give in your blanket? He gives examples about these totalitarian governments that persecute and prohibit Christianity. And it's still going on today. We see it going on, particularly in Muslim countries in Africa, that Christians are not allowed to practice their faith. So persecution becomes a very strong factor throughout church history. Then we have polity. Okay? Polity is basically church government. Okay? Government within the church. We have three types of church government. Okay? Anybody know the three types of church government that are out there? They're sort of models, if you will. They're not necessarily, because most churches sort of fall in a combination. First form is what's called episcopal. Obviously, episcopal church is that form of government. And what episcopal means comes from the Greek. And we're going to come across this. Episkopos, which means an overseer or a bishop. Okay? So, a church with an episcopal form of government sort of looks like this. You know, you have single people, bishops, monsignors, etc. You know, levels, hierarchy of men that are in charge until you get down to the congregation. You know, now this guy up here is probably in charge of, you know, several guys here, and these guys are in charge of several guys here, you know, but there's sort of a hierarchy of single men that are in charge. Okay, the next one is Presbyterian, coming from the Greek presbyteros, which means an elder. Okay, this one looks like this. This is the way the Presbyterian Church is set up. You know, you've got a council, a group of elders, a board, if you will, okay, a committee that is over another committee. In the Presbyterian Church, they call them synods. You know, and you have. And again, this works where this committee is over multiple committees, you know, and then these guys are over multiple committees, and it still works in sort of a hierarchical way, but it's not single men in the hierarchy, it's committees, groups of elders that are in the committee. The last form of government that we find in church today I don't have a Greek word for it because it's not in the Bible. Congregation. That is democracy. Everybody votes on everything. You know, mob rule, if you will. It is The congregation is really the ones in charge. And they decide, everything goes to congregational vote. And that's why in congregational churches, it's crucial that they maintain membership, proper membership. Because in order to vote on what you want in your church, they want to make sure that you are a member of the church in good standing, that you are, number one, that you're a believer. Now, and I'm not saying this is an evil form of government. I don't see it in the Bible. And I don't think it's an effective form. But there were the Baptist Church is congregational. Obviously, the Congregational Church is congregational. The Puritans were a congregational form of government. They have to maintain very strict membership. And it goes right down to tithe tracking. You have to make sure that you're still giving. If you're not giving, then you can lose your membership. You know?
Why is a strict membership any different in a congregational than the Episcopalian or Presbyterian?
Because you technically don't even have to have a membership in either of these two. You know, because there's no leadership in the membership. You know, there's no decision making, if you will, in the membership. In these two, the leadership, everything is decided. This one, everything is decided by a board. In this one, everything is decided by one man.
No, just a sad story that came out last week. Some lady died. She hadn't been a member of the church for 2 years because she was in the hospital. And the pastor responded to the family after she died, "We're not going to do her funeral. She hasn't been tithing." She's been in the hospital for 2 years.
Yeah.
She hasn't been kept on keeping up with her dues.
And I've heard the reverse, where somebody was excommunicated from a church for being divorced, and then got a call and said, "Yeah, we haven't been receiving your tithes for the last couple of years." And he said, "I was excommunicated." Well, they said, "Well, you still have to tithe."
Wow.
But yeah, you don't really need, with these, leadership. Now, you will see membership in these types of churches. I don't see biblical reference to membership. And when I say membership, I mean legal, lawful, membership to where, you have certain voting rights, you have certain rights within the church that you can exercise that have an effect on the legal standing of the church and things like that. Again, I'm not necessarily making a blanket statement as to which one is better and which one is worse. Just so you know where we stand, we are sort of, what Calvary Chapel has is what they call the Mosaic model. Okay? Mosaic model is basically combination of these two, okay, with a mosaic twist on it. If you think of what did Jethro tell Moses? This is too much for you. This is one man can't do all this. You need to have some men under you, and then some men under those men, and then some men under those men. And so what we do here at Calvary Chapel, sort of in this mosaic rule, is we have a combination of Episcopal and Presbyteros, in that we have a pastor. He is the head of this church. He is the leader, the CEO of this church. In legal terminologies, he is the president and CEO of Calvary Chapel Gulf Coast Inc. Okay. However, in this church, we have two leadership boards. We have a board of directors, which is sort of the business end of things. We handle the financial and business dealings that the church just has to deal with for being an institution in the United States. And then we also have what's called the Board of Elders, which is a little bit of a larger board, which is the ministerial leadership of the church. It deals mainly with things having to do with ministry, the growth of the church, church events, things having to do with the congregation, not really having anything to do with the business and financial end of things. the most active member, the most active board in this church is the Board of Elders. That is, as far as we're concerned, that is the leadership. You know, legally, the Board of Directors is on paper the head of this church, but as far as the direction that this church takes, it is our overseer, Pastor Bill, and the Board of Elders that is both a source of accountability and a source of information and support for the pastor, but also a source of distribution of authority, delegated authority, like Moses had. I mean, if Pastor Bill had to do everything around here, it would be too overwhelming. It's fine if you get a little church of 10 or 15 or 20, but as you start getting a church that's bigger and bigger and bigger, you need to start setting up people that will help you. You can delegate out these things. And that, you know, that's the form of leadership that we have in this church. Again, I'm not saying that's the best form, it's just the kind that we have and it works for us.
Are there any examples of congregational churches available today?
Baptist.
Oh, Baptist.
Baptist and congregational. Congregational churches are congregational, I mean, obviously. But it's tough to find. Unless you go up to New England, you're going to have a hard time finding a congregational church.
When you say Baptist, you mean Southern Baptist?
Baptist in general. Baptist in general. For the most part, Baptists are congregational in their, you know. Southern Baptists are not, give you a quick little history on the Baptist church. Baptist church is technically a non-denominational church. Baptists are not a denomination. They may be members of the Southern Baptist Convention, they may be members of Northern Baptists, you know, there's different conventions, if you will, of Baptists. But each Baptist church is owned by, run by, and controlled by that church. There is no government above them. Okay. For example, Assembly of God is a denomination. If you are an Assembly of God pastor, and I'm not entirely, I think they have a similar form of government.
Congregational.
Is it congregational?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
But they are a denomination where the pastor answers to somebody higher than him, you know, and there are multiple denominations that if there is a higher authority, okay, I think Evangelical Free is also a denomination. Again, there's a government over you. The Christian Missionary Alliance, matter of fact, Christian Missionary Alliance, they own the property that the church is on. They learned that because the Assembly of God broke off from them and took all the properties. So now if you want to be a Christian Missionary Alliance church, you can be the pastor of that church, but the Christian Missionary Alliance owns that property no matter what. You know, so when there is a body behind you that can fire you, that tells you, you know, hey, you need to stop doing that, you need to, you know. Calvary Chapel is an affiliation, an association, where, you know, it's sort of like a right hand of fellowship. We are allowed to use the name Calvary Chapel because we hold to generally the polity and the doctrinal beliefs of Calvary Chapel Association. But there is no legal or financial ties between us and Calvary Chapel Association. Calvary Chapel Association, especially since Chuck's passing, is set up where there is a board of it's board of directors, basically, but they call it something else. Board of advisors, I think. That are spread out across the country, and each one has a different region that they sort of oversee, but they don't have any authority. It's more of a support system. So let's just say I wanted to go out and I wanted to start a Calvary Chapel church somewhere in Florida. I would talk to Malcolm Wild up in Merritt Island. He is the advisor for Calvary Chapel Association for the state of Florida. And I would just sit down with him and say, I'd like to start a Calvary church, and he would talk to me, and he would talk to Bill, and he'd say, blah, 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 blah. This seems like a good idea. Go ahead, you can use our name, you can slap that name on your thing. That's it. I mean, it's just sort of permission. if I had a Calvary Chapel church and I started teaching something that went, you know, seriously against the doctrinal stance of the Calvary Chapel church, they'd say, look, that's up to you. You do what you want to do. Just take that, you know, take that name off your son if you don't want to. Okay? Call yourself something else. Don't call yourself Calvary Chapel because you're not even a confused preacher. You know? So Calvary Chapel is, each church is completely indigenous and self-contained. Baptist church is very much that way, but they become very dependent on their, you know, on their conferences, the leadership in their conferences, but they're still separate. So, you know, denominationalism doesn't necessarily have anything to do with this. They can have any of these forms of, you know, although if they've got these two, more than likely it's denominational because there is some kind of leadership that is above, you know, if they're strictly one of these two, there's some kind of a leadership process.
But it's not a democratic process like we have a congregation.
Yeah, exactly. Congregational votes on everything. Call it the drapes. You know, I mean, they can form committees to come up with little decisions like that and whatnot, but, you know, as far as everything that goes on, everything gets put to vote.
They vote on everything.
Exactly. So that's church polity. Next is polemics. Is the church declaring where it stands, fighting heresy, declaring its position, dogma, doctrine, you know, creeds, things like that. When the church comes out and says, look, this is what we believe, that's polemics. And we're going to see that particularly in the first couple of centuries of the church that heresies start to pop up. And the church has to step in and say, well, wait a minute. You know, up to this point, everyone's kind of very happy-go-lucky. Well, we all just believe the Bible. We all love, and we're, you know, we're just doing our thing and having church and having fun. And then these other guys go up and say, nah, I don't necessarily believe what you're teaching there. And some of them came up with some pretty wild things. We'll talk about a couple of them tonight. So the church had to go, well, wait a minute. Did we officially state where we stand on this? No. Okay, well, now we do. And we're going to see that comes up through the centuries, really. The next one is praxis. I know some of these are just sort of fancy words. It just means practical outworking of faith. As we study church history, we're going to see that the church takes different stands on ethics, on how you live a Christian life, what it means to live a Christian life, what kind of behavior should you be showing, how does it display in your home, in your work, in charity. It's just sort of the outworking of faith. And then lastly is presentation. This really has to do with the education of the church. You know, whether it's an educational system you have in training your children, putting together some kind of what they would call a catechism, you know, or a curriculum, preaching. Your hymns, you know, the things your worship practices, if you will, you know, your liturgy, how you worship, the architecture. We're going to see it demonstrated in the architecture of the church and in art. We see particularly during the Renaissance, it was an explosion of artwork, and most of it was all, you know, we look at, you know, works of Da Vinci and Michelangelo and things like that. A lot of their work was based on the church and church history. And they would use their art to demonstrate their own particular bent on history. Even, you know, this is an example. When I was in Italy, I was in St. Peter's Basilica. Anybody been to St. Peter's? Remember the statue with the nail in the toe? Did they show you that? There's this one statue, I forget who it is now. There's a statue there, and there's somebody, I think it's just one of the popes, and he's got his foot on a globe, and there is a nail from his toe going into England. And it's, it was, it represented when King Henry broke from the church. And it was, and the I can't think of his name, and the Archbishop of Canterbury.
Beckett.
Yeah, Beckett, yeah. And it was all that controversy going on. They were breaking from the Catholic Church. And there's a nail, just in the sculpture, there's a nail going through Great Britain underneath this, underneath the Pope's foot. You know, and that kind of stuff came out in art. It was just sort of their way of presenting their particular bent, their particular belief system. So we see different types of presentation, at, again, as we go through history. Important thing to remember is that, you know, history is seamless. I mean, we, for the sake of teaching it, we have to sort of break it up. Just to make it workable. But, you know, as we know, there's no exact lines, there's no exact dates to say, okay, well, this period went from this to this, and that's it, you know. But as we look at history, this one, I'll just, it's too much to write down. Did something happen? There we go. I got my slides messed up. As we look at it through this class, there's three major periods of history. We have ancient, medieval, and modern church history. Ancient history from 5 BC, really, from basically the birth of Christ, and just looking at the structure and culture of the world at that time, and watching it spread throughout the empire, and what's called the Old Catholic Imperial Church. Now, I want to make a distinction, as we use that term, I want to make a distinction between Catholic and Roman Catholic. Okay? Catholic means universal. So we're going to see in creeds, and we're going to see in, you know, in documents that were written by early church fathers, the word Catholic Church. All that means is, because up until 1517, there was one Christian church. Okay? And at one point, there was a schism, so they had the Eastern and the Western and all that kind of, but they still, even though they hated each other, they were like, you know, they were like brothers that were, had a fight. They still considered themselves part of the same church, but they just didn't like each other. But essentially, up until the Reformation, there was one church, the Catholic Church. And it meant the universal church. Now, around the medieval time, a little prior, you know, we end up right around the 4th century, 4th to 5th century, we sort of shift from the old Catholic Imperial to the Christian Roman Empire, or the Roman Catholic Church. And that was when the church, the Catholic Church, merged with the Roman Empire and eventually formed the Roman Catholic Church, if you will. Because even for a while, even after the merging, there were still arguments as to where the center of the church would be, whether it would be in Rome. There were issues of whether it would be in Rome or Antioch or Alexandria or Jerusalem, Constantinople, as it was called at the time. So from 5 to 590, you've got spread throughout the empire, Old Catholic Imperial Church, Christian Roman Empire. Then the medieval years, the medieval church, we have the Holy Roman Empire. This is after the fall of Rome. Rome sort of came back, but in a different manifestation. It was no longer a political government. It was really a ruling of the popes. The empire, the Roman Empire, I mean the Roman Emperor, if you will, was a puppet to the Pope. And so for a lot of years, we had the Holy Roman Empire, and which led to the supremacy of the Pope. The Pope was absolute rule. And also during this time, we had the Renaissance. Rebirth after the Dark Ages, the rebirth of education and art, things like that. A lot of it is reflected in the church. Then we have the modern, which we say from 1517, or the Reformation and the Counter-Reformation. Counter-Reformation was just sort of Catholic Church. After everybody left, the Catholic Church said, okay, well maybe we need to change some things, and they changed a few things. And they called it the Catholic Reformation, Counter-Reformation. Then we have the Enlightenment, which is going to play a really important role in what happened to the church right after the Reformation. Reformation was an amazing thing, but then it kind of hijacked by the Enlightenment, and they started going off in weird ways. But again, as you're going to see through history, there's always little lights. In the middle of that, we had modern missions. We had the return of great missionary endeavors, William Carey, Hudson Taylor, and then like that. And then moving into American Christianity, which we're going to see was just an amazing movement that God brought about to bring that how we were founded to be a Christian nation. So these are kind of how we're going to break up the history of the church. As we get into the first century here, we can look at this and go back. The influences on the church during the time of the apostles. Three basic areas of influence: Rome, politics, it was unity of the law. Some of these things were good, some of them weren't good. There was the concept of a universal law. Everybody was under this same law. Okay? It was free movement. Because of the Pax Romana, people were free to go wherever they wanted to go, for the most part. They could get on a ship. If they had the money, they could go where they wanted to go. And it opened the door to missions at just the right time. You know, in Galatians, it talks about the fullness of time that Christ came. And in Mark 1:15, it also talks about when the time is fulfilled. You know, everything was ready for Christ to come in the preparation. He came at just the right time to launch the church, to birth the church at a time when the church was going to have its most going for it. Also, the system of roads that Rome produced. That was one of their signature things. All roads lead to Rome. They built roadways that made travel easier. Persecution from Rome was, in one sense, was a negative thing. But, it was said of those days that the blood of the martyrs was the seed of the church. When the church was just getting off the ground, it fell into severe persecution that actually ended up feeding the church. It caused the church to close ranks and become stronger. The Greeks brought an intellectual approach to things, moving away from polytheism, pantheism, and animism of the ancient days. They moved more toward, not necessarily toward a monotheism, but against sort of this worship of nature and paganism. And more leaning toward an intellectual look at things. Plato, Aristotle, and Socrates, for that matter, talked about the logos. I mean, we talk about the logos, but they technically coined the phrase, the idea of the logos being an expression of a pure mind. And then that was used in the language, because that was the other thing that we had, was a common language, which was very precise and very expressive in the Greek language. It was like using the word agape. There really was not a great application for the word agape in the Greek language. It's very rarely found in anything other than the Bible. But yet it was a Greek word, and it gained its best application in the scriptures. And there was a desire to know truth among the Greeks. And when I say the Greeks, it doesn't necessarily mean those that were ethnically Greek, because when the Greeks took over in the first couple of centuries BC, their approach was very different from the Romans. Romans were strong, were harsh, were powerful. They came in and they crushed you and then said, all right, just live the way you want. I don't care. You do, spin whatever web you want to spin. You be whoever you want to be. You believe what you want to believe. I don't care. Just don't cause trouble. Don't stir the pot. And we'll leave you alone. The Greeks came in and conquered and said, no, you've got to become Greek. You need to wear Greek clothes, you need to shave your face, you need to cut your hair, you need to speak Greek. They immersed people in the Greek culture. So by the time Jesus comes on the scene, Rome is in charge, but that Greek culture is well in place. That's when we read in the book of Acts, when it talks about the Greeks and the Hellenists, it's not talking about Greeks, it's talking about the Jews who were of a Greek persuasion. They took on Greek culture. So, but it provides the language, not only for the New Testament, but even for the Old Testament. It created the Septuagint as people were no longer reading and understanding Hebrew because of the Babylonian captivity. Now Greek was the language, and they decided to translate the scholars, 70 scholars in Alexandria, Egypt, that's why it's called the Septuagint. Septuagint means 70. 70 scholars in Alexandria sat down and translated the Old Testament from Hebrew into Greek to preserve it so that people of that generation would be able to read the Bible because they didn't read Hebrew.
When did they do that?
It was around 100, 120 BC. You know, a little bit before the time of Christ, but it was in that time when the Romans were moving in, but the culture was still very, very Greek. And then, of course, the last influence is the Jews. You know, we have to thank from them the preservation of the Scriptures. We have the Old Testament. We have the history of our church prior to the birth of the church, because the Jews preserved the Scripture. We have monotheism from the Jews. Not saying that we borrow monotheism from them, but when the Greeks sort of started dismissing the idea of polytheism and pantheism and animism and sort of this worship of nature and paganism that was going out of vogue, the idea of monotheism was becoming more popular or more socially acceptable. You know, before it was not considered even sensible to be a monotheist. Why only have one? Why not have as many gods as you want? You know, but they were coming into a time when monotheism was becoming more acceptable because of the Jews.
So mythology kind of ended when Plato and Aristotle.
Yeah, they said, you know, we're too smart for that stuff. We don't believe in all that kind of stuff. But they, you know, it just became more about intellectual understanding than it did about religion and, you know, the supernatural. System of ethics and divine law, again, you know, the Jews had, they followed a law not from king, but from a book. That had never been done before. And hadn't been done up until the Roman Empire. Roman Empire, even though they had an emperor, the emperor was still subject to the Senate on some levels and to political law. And then the Jews had the diaspora, which was when the Jews went into captivity in Babylon, when they got released, not all of them went back to Israel. And some of them left Babylon but didn't go back to Israel and went other places. The time of Jesus, you see at the time of Pentecost, it says people from all over the place, Northern Africa, you know, Egypt, from Syria, from all over the place. There were Jews spread all over the place. And again, that created the opportunity for this message, because we've got to remember that this message was originally a Jewish message, if you will, as it started in its inception. And then we had, and this is where, while we broke, as I said earlier, while we broke from the synagogue, we have the principle of the synagogue. The synagogue was invented during the Babylonian captivity because they didn't have a temple to worship it. So what they would do is in their communities, and they couldn't build a temple in Babylon, and they couldn't build even one single place in Babylon where they could all go to, because some of them would say, I'm a slave, I'm a servant, I'm not allowed to just get up and, you know, travel 90 miles to go to some central place. So each little community had their own gathering together. And they would meet on a weekly basis. And they would sit, just like we heard on this past Sunday morning. The rabbi would get up, he would open the scripture, he would read it, give the meaning, and then he would sit down. You know, and from that model, the church sort of carried, even though we couldn't, the Jews, the Christian Jews, couldn't meet in the synagogues anymore, they still carried out that model in their church liturgy, if you will. So that's sort of the background. You know, we have to at least cover the some of Christ's approach, because, I mean, he said himself that he founded the church, that it is his church. And from a historical perspective, Jesus is probably one of the most documented historical figures in history. Very few people, with the exception of some stubborn-headed, whatever you want to call them, most people believe that Jesus existed. There are some who say, no, somebody invented him, he's not a real figure in history. But for the most part, those who have any understanding of history absolutely agree. There's historical records from a man named Tacitus and Pliny, and we all have probably heard of Josephus, Flavius Josephus, all make record of Jesus of Nazareth, that he was there. At the very least, that he was a teacher, that he existed, that he was a historical person. So, yeah, as far as history is concerned, there's really very little doubt as to the historicity of Jesus himself. Now, the question becomes, when it comes to the church, what were his intentions? Because there were those today that would say, well, Jesus never meant to build an organization. Jesus never meant for there to be organized religion. You know, he was just sort of teaching philosophy and wanted people to sort of follow his lead and follow his philosophical teachings. But we see, if you have your Bibles, and you should, we can turn to Matthew 16, verse 18, well-known verse, and I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, my ecclesia, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. And then 18:17, just a page over. And this is just sort of, he's giving some advice as to some of the procedures that we need to go through. And if he refuses to hear them, tell it to the church. But if he refuses to hear even the church, let him be to you like a heathen and a tax collector. Okay? So Jesus intended for there to be a church. Some kind of entity. It wasn't going to be some loose. He even had procedures that you should go to. If somebody's not hearing you, go to your brother. If you have aught with him, if he won't receive it, take another. If he won't receive the two of you, then go to the church. You know, he is operating on the assumption that there is a church. And at the time when he's saying this, there isn't one. So Jesus clearly is in his intention for there to be an organization or an entity that is the church. In Luke 6:13, this may not seem like much of a reference, but it's very important. Luke 6:13. And when it was day, he called his disciples to himself, and from them he chose 12, whom he also named apostles. Very important, because the word apostle means sent ones, sent out ones. Apostoleo. Apo means away from, stoleo means sent. Those who were sent away. So Jesus wasn't saying, look, we just got our little group here, we're going to stay here, we're going to do our own little thing and have our own little philosophy, and maybe people will want to be here for as long as it lasts. No, he intended for this thing to be spread. He sent people away and called them. These are my sent ones to go up. You know, and then, of course, we have in Matthew 28 and Mark 16 and, you know, in every gospel, the Great Commission, go into all the world. Preach the gospel to every creature. Baptize, you know, make disciples of all men, baptizing in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. He's obviously telling them to go out and create something. Go out and build a body of people. So we know that Jesus' intention was for there to be a church. So for these people who say, well, I believe in organized religion, well, Jesus did. I don't know what you believe in. I don't know if you believe in disorganized religion. I don't know if that's any better. But, you know, if it's not organized, what is it? There should be some kind of an entity. It doesn't have to be, you know, so overly organized that it's stifling, but there needs to be an entity. You know, it's not just a bunch of people wandering around with a philosophy. So then we move on to the birth of the church. Out of the Gospels into the book of Acts. Pentecost. Acts 2. I'll try to see if I can speed things up. These classes are probably going to run at least an hour and a half, maybe a little more, you know, because I've got to fit this into 8 weeks. So it's, you know, don't need to hold you here too long.
We're not finishing it.
10? We'll be done by 10. I promise we'll be done by 10. Pentecost was a Jewish festival, was a Jewish holiday that celebrated the Feast of First Fruits. It was 50 days after Passover. It was the day when the first crop came in. And what we see in Acts 2, 1 through 4, the Holy Spirit fell on the 120 that were in the upper room. And then Peter went out and preached a message, and thousands came to the church. And they were the first fruits. And it says, and these people were added to the church. We see early on, get to Acts 2. You don't have to turn there. I'm just going to read it so we can kind of move through quickly. Very early on, and again, this is one of those examples where, well, what? How should the church work? Well, look at what they did in the very beginning. They, the apostles, you know, Jesus, it was Jesus' church, and Jesus founded it, but the apostles are the first ones to put it into practice. And so they're the ones that were hearing from God, that were being led by God to do certain things. And it's very important for us to see, well, what did these people do? And it doesn't necessarily mean we have to do exactly what they did, but understanding where they were coming from. We look at Acts 2, starting in verse 42, and they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, in the breaking of bread and in prayers. Fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. Now all who believed were together and had all things in common, and sold their possessions and goods, and divided them among all as anyone had need. So continuing daily in one accord in the temple, breaking bread, and from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with all people. And the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved. You know, there's a blueprint for us. You know? That doesn't mean that, okay, everybody, give me all your money. You know, hand in all your money now. It's just saying they had everything in common. They helped each other out. It was voluntary. It wasn't mandatory. It was not imposed upon them. When Ananias and Sapphira held back the money, what did the apostles say? They said, it was yours to do with as you pleased. We didn't tell you you had to do anything. You could have kept it. You were fine. Nobody asked you for it. It was yours to do what you wanted. You said you would give it, and then you lied. That's the problem. They didn't get, they were not struck down for not giving enough or for holding stuff back. They were struck down for lying to the Holy Spirit. So it was voluntary. These were some of the early practices, and we're going to see the ordinances being played out. Before we get to the ordinances, though, part of the ordinance is really part of the organization. We see the church coming together in the New Testament, particularly through the epistles. We see it sort of some of the activity in the book of Acts, but we see particularly under the teachings of Paul, we see officers. We've talked about most of them, you know, the bishops and the elders, and the last one is the deacons. Okay, deacons we see in Acts 6, the Hellenists, the widows, the Greek widows that they're called, they were not being part of, when the food was being distributed to the widows, the Greek widows were being left out. Because some of the Jews were racist. Again, church is made up of people. And they said, no, they shouldn't get in. And so they went, so the Hellenists went to the apostles and said, hey, we're not getting our fair share. We're believers. Just because we wear Greek clothes and we look Greek doesn't mean that we're not, you know, we're believers. And Jewish believers at that point. There really weren't any Gentile believers. And the apostles said, well, our hands are full. We're trying to bring this message to the world. We need to spend time in prayer and studying the word. Appoint men. Just let's find some good, holy, strong, godly men that can do the right thing and oversee this. And that was the deacons. You know, we see Paul talking about elders. For the most part, when they talk about the leadership of the church, they're talking about elders. And elders are always in the plural. That's why, again, it's probably not scriptural to have a purely hierarchical system where it's just single men over everything. When he talked about elders, he was always in the plural. For the most part, when he talked about bishops, he would say the bishop. And that's kind of where we get the system that we have today, where we have one overseer, but we have a group of elders. And we see that. We see the deacons in Acts 6, elders we see in 1 Timothy 3, bishops we see in Titus 1. Next we have ordinances. Okay, there's, you know, the different churches, depending on their liturgy, depending on what they hold to, have a number of ordinances. For the most part, we only see two ordinances spelled out in the scripture, and that is the Lord's Supper in Acts 20, verse 7, and baptism in Acts 2. Baptism is, you know, absolutely clear. Jesus said, baptize, make disciples of all men, baptizing in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And then when he had his Last Supper, he said, do this as often as you eat and drink. Do this in remembrance of me. And we see references to the Lord's Supper, even in what we just read. When it talked about the breaking of bread, it's talking about the Lord's Supper. You know, and then there's other references to doing this on the first day of the week. That's why we practice on Sunday and not Saturday. But it doesn't matter. It's not, Sunday is not the Sabbath. You want to talk about what the Sabbath is? Well, in Hebrew, Shabbat means seven. That's all it means. Sabbath means the seventh. So it's just like in Spanish. No. Saturday.
Oh.
Sabbath. The Sabbath. Right.
Yes.
Saturday is the Sabbath. As Christians, you know, Jesus said that man was made for the Sabbath. The Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. You know, the Sabbath is in our heart. We take a day for the Lord. If Sunday is our Sabbath, then great, that's our Sabbath. But we worship on Sunday because of the resurrection and because it's what they do. Now, there's no law that says we have to. That's why it's not an ordinance. It's not something that we, you know, there are a lot of churches now, especially big churches. You go to Fort Lauderdale, they got like, you know, a couple of Saturday night services. They've got multiple services on Sunday. They got services all through the week, you know, and you get to these mega churches, they get churches, they get worship services all week long. And that's fine, you know, but the reason why we do it on Sunday is because it was mentioned several times in the scripture to worship on Saturday. One of the things that we see in the book of Acts is two men creating a bridge between the Old Testament and the New Testament. We see Peter and we see Stephen. Again, I won't cover it exhaustively, but you know, maybe that's something you can do this week, is take some time and read in Acts 2, Peter's sermon, and in Acts 7, Stephen's sermon. Both of them do the same thing masterfully, in different ways, but they both go through the Old Testament. They take their audience through the Old Testament. Abraham, Moses, David, you know, and they, the prophet, you know, they talk about the different prophets, and they just bring the people through the Old Testament and say, now, this man Jesus, and as Peter put, whom you crucified. You know, Peter says, who you know well who I'm talking about. You know, and Stephen does the same thing. Stephen challenges the Sanhedrin, gets before the Sanhedrin, and challenges them, gives them their own history, and then says, look, if you don't get how this is showing Jesus, then I don't know what to tell you. You know, and they create that bridge so that people, and more than likely, God was not having them preach this message to the Sanhedrin or to the authorities, because the authorities were going to reject no matter what. But the people were listening. And the people heard this bridge being created between their old religion and the Messiah, and making that connection. So, you know, again, after Peter's message in particular, we see thousands, and then saying thousands and thousands being added to the church. And Jerusalem, being the place where it all started, was the headquarters until about 62 AD, when James, the brother of John, was killed by Herod pretty early on. But James, the brother of Jesus, who was the pastor, if you will, the overseer of the church, the head of the church in Jerusalem, until he was assassinated by the high priest in 62 AD. After that, Jerusalem, in addition to, at 62 AD, was going through a political upheaval. The Zealots were constantly making terrorist attacks on the Romans. So Jerusalem was in political upheaval. James was gone. The Jerusalem church was in trouble. They had no real leadership. In addition to that, as they approached 70 AD, people actually received visions that they needed to get out of Jerusalem. Christians received visions that they needed to get out of Jerusalem, and they left. And then Titus came in and sacked Jerusalem and destroyed the temple. And that's why, again, majority of them, they were Jewish Christians leaving Jerusalem. And up until that point, they were still welcome in the synagogue, even though they were Christians. After that, they were considered traitors because they thought that they knew something was going to happen. Well, they did, but they knew because God told them. But they thought they were in on it. The Jews thought that the Christians were in on the attack on Jerusalem. So after 70 AD, they were no longer even allowed in the synagogues. It was you, if you wanted to be a Jew, you were a Jew. You can't be a Christian and a Jew. It's part of the Jewish mindset. But also, because of that, Jerusalem was no longer the center, and it was moved to Antioch. And we even see that happening early on, because missionaries are being sent out from Antioch. And we even see Paul talking to different churches, saying that the church in Jerusalem needs help. They're in financial trouble. They need to take offerings to help out the church in Jerusalem. You know, they're doing badly. And this was all prior to the fall of Jerusalem. But Antioch sort of took over, became the head of operations for the church. And that's where they were first called Christians. We read that in Acts 11:26. First called Christians in Antioch. They were also called the Way, and they were called the Nazarenes. In Acts 9:19-24, those are actually three different chapters. Acts chapter 9, Acts chapter 19, and Acts chapter 24, they were called the Way. And they were also called Nazarenes in Acts 24, verse 5. But Antioch quickly became the base of operations, particularly the base for missionary operations, where we see Paul and Barnabas being sent out on missionary journeys. And we see here, this is, we've probably already seen this before this, everybody can see this in the back of the Bible. These are Paul's missionary journeys. You know, you can look at that for a second, that color coding, you can see. You know, he starts off, just going outside the camera here. His first one in purple. He just kind of stayed local. He just kind of made a loop and went around. You know, second journey, you know, he kind of went way around. third journey, he really just retraced his steps for the most part of the second journey. The fourth missionary journey was sort of a missionary journey. He was under arrest, and he was traveling to Rome. What's that?
He made the
change. Yeah, in chains, right? But he wanted to go to Rome, and he was arrested because he wanted to be arrested. He forced himself to be arrested because he wanted to go to Rome. And that was his free ticket. He had wanted to go to Rome anyway. Now he got a free ticket. The empire was going to pay for his ticket to Rome.
Is that really why he had to go to Caesar?
Yeah, because he wanted to go to Rome. I mean, one part of it was to save his skin, you know, because I'm a Roman citizen, and, you know, I feel the season. But, you know, there were several times when he could have just, you know, I think it was either under Felix or Festus, they were just, it was kind of like, yeah. Just go.
One of them said if he didn't go to Caesar, they would have let him go.
Yeah, exactly. But he wanted to go to Rome. Well, you know, Paul really wanted to go to Rome. So he got himself a free trip. And one of the things I think is interesting is that in Acts 13:13, you know, we see in Acts 13, we see Barnabas goes and gets Paul. You know, Paul got saved, Acts 9, you know, knocked off his horse, we all know the story. But then he goes into hiding because everybody's afraid of him. Even though he's a believer, for 11 years he stays in hiding. Barnabas, son of consolation, goes and says, you know, I remember this guy Paul that got saved, and he was the guy that persecuted us for years. I want to see if he'd like to join me in some missionary journey. So he goes and he gets Paul, Saul, and they start their first missionary journey as Barnabas and Saul. And early on in the journey, in Acts 13:13, it says Paul and his company, which just goes to show that Paul, you know, Barnabas was a great man, but Paul was the gifted leader. You know, he was the one that God had chosen to be the apostle that would replace Judas. So early on, he was the leader of that trip. And so we see Paul going out and hitting the Gentile world. Meanwhile, Peter is back in Jerusalem. he's getting a message now to make this jump. And we've got to make this jump. Now, everybody who's saved is Jews. We're all Jewish, with, you know, a few exceptions. We see the Ethiopian eunuch, you know, getting saved by Philip. But for the most part, everybody getting saved are Jews. And even Paul, as he starts his missionary journey, the first place he goes, because remember the diaspora had Jews all over this region. The first place Paul goes, he goes to the synagogue. He goes to the synagogues first, and he preaches the message to the Jews. When the Jews refuse him, he goes and he preaches to the Gentiles. But now we see in Acts 10 and Acts 11, Peter is getting a revelation that the Gentiles need to be included. He sees the vision on the roof. He's told to go speak to Cornelius. You know, and he's there. I can't do these things. He goes, they get saved, and then the council starts yelling at Peter, what are you doing? You went and met with the impure. You went with the Gentiles. And he said, look, they're believers. I saw the Holy Spirit fall on them. They're filled with the Holy Spirit. What do you want me to say? You know? And then this sort of gets codified in Acts 15 when a dispute rises up with Paul, because Paul is preaching to the Gentiles, but he's not forcing them to be circumcised. He's not forcing them to become Jews first. Because they finally said, okay, we'll let the Gentiles become Christians, but they got to become a Jew first, and they can become a Christian. And then Paul says, no, we're not going to do that. And at that point, Peter supported him and said, look, you know, you guys know what I believe. You know, you guys know what I saw, what I told you. They didn't get circumcised. They didn't become Jews. They got filled with the Holy Spirit, and they're believers. Peter later sort of cowered back and said, well, you know, maybe, you know, I won't eat with them. You know, I think they're amazing, but I don't think I'm going to sit at the same table as them. Paul the reed blowing in the wind. Simon, the bending reed. Paul said he rebuked him openly. I'm rebuking Peter. So all right, Next thing I want to cover, just before we wrap things up, is the role of the Holy Spirit. Now, without the Holy Spirit, there is no church. And I don't care what denomination, what persuasion of Christianity you come from, whether you feel like you want to emphasize the Holy Spirit or not, you wouldn't be here if it wasn't for the Holy Spirit. Jesus told them, I am going to send you a comforter. John 14, John 15, and John 16, he said, he's going to teach you in all things. He's going to be your paraclete. He's going to come beside you. He's going to be your helper. He told them, stay in Jerusalem a little while until you are endued with power, until the Holy Spirit comes upon you. Wait, don't do anything. Don't go launching out and planting this new church that I told you to plant until the Holy Spirit is upon you. Because if the Holy Spirit is not upon you, then it is entirely the work of man. Without the Holy Spirit empowering us to build the church. One of the things that I really admire about Bill is anything that he decides he's going to do about this, we're going to pray about it. We're going to wait and see what the Holy Spirit does. And then do crazy things that make no sense because the Holy Spirit said do it. Look at this building. It's just, we should be under arrest for being in this building. But the Holy Spirit moved. And we move when the Holy Spirit moves. When the Holy Spirit doesn't move, we don't move. One of the things that we always say here, we just do the next thing. If the Holy Spirit doesn't tell us what the next thing is, then we're just going to keep doing the last thing the Holy Spirit told us to do. What's that military thing? You follow out the last order you received, right? Takes a military man to avoid that. That's what you do. You follow the last, whatever the last order was, you do it until you're told something else. And that's the way the church operates, or is supposed to operate, under the influence and the power of the Holy Spirit. As the church grew, they started facing resistance. Resistance and heresy. These are some of the obstacles that just very early on in the church. Jewish authorities, we saw that early on in the book of Acts, capturing Paul and Silas, Peter and John, and arresting them and beating them, saying, don't do this anymore, doing these things. Roman authorities, we started seeing, and we're gonna see how the Roman authorities really played a part in resistance. And then facing heresies, we see Paul talking about the Judaizers, Jewish Christians. And then legalism, facing some of the heresies, the legalists, which also were the Judaizers. They were also Gnostics. And these are people that were sort of left over from the Greek philosophy days. They believed that it was all about having a higher knowledge, and that it wasn't necessarily about the person of Jesus Christ, but it was about having a better understanding. And the Gnostics, sort of, they were dualists in that they divided material and spiritual. Everything spiritual was good. Everything material is evil. And that's why they didn't believe that that Jesus could have taken on human form. And one of the other heresies that grew out of that was what was called the Docetists, which were people that said that Jesus was not human. Now, there were those that said he wasn't God, and then there were others that said he wasn't human. That he only appeared, he took on the appearance of human form. And he appeared to be human, but he was not fully human. And we see a lot of these addressed in Paul's epistles. He talks about the Judaizers in Galatians. In Colossians, he talks about in him dwells all the fullness of God bodily. Paul puts that in there for the Gnostics and the Docetists so that they see in him dwelt all the fullness of God in human form, bodily. So Paul is dealing with these different heresies and things that are going on. Also during this time, we have the writing of the scriptures. Yeah, I'm not going to spend a lot of time in this because we know who the authors are. We've been through most of this. But around the time of 4850 AD to about 96 AD, we have the time when the Holy Spirit is moving men. Not all of them were apostles. We all, growing up, we heard that scripture was given to us by the apostles. Well, they weren't all apostles. Some of them were. Most of them were not apostles. Mark was not an apostle. Luke was not an apostle. Technically, Jude and James were not apostles. We don't really know who wrote Hebrews. Probably Paul. Most likely Paul. We have, these were just men that moved by the Holy Spirit, inspired by the Holy Spirit, not automatons, not just, so possessed that they just started not knowing what they were writing, but being moved. They were hearing from God and writing. They had an intent. That's why it's always important when we study the scriptures to know who they were writing to, when they were writing, what was the purpose of their writing. So we sort of know the intent that was behind it, but then we also have the Holy Spirit behind it, inspiring every word, so that each word is God-breathed. And then we even have other writings. And again, it's like the Federalist Papers. We have, from men like Clement, Polycarp, and Ignatius, who were writing. And this was, the epistles was not an unusual form of literature. This is how, again, borrowing from the Greek culture, this is how they communicated, this is how they taught, the epistles. And so they borrowed this structure to write to these different churches. And we even have, there are books that were written by Paul that are not in the scripture. Paul talks to, I think it's in Colossians. He says, send your letter to Laodicea, and let them send you their letter that I wrote to them. We don't have the gospel, the epistle to the Laodiceans in our scripture. So it's not just that everything that was written was scripture, it's everything that was determined was inspired by the Holy Spirit, and it was preserved, because we got to believe that if that letter to the Laodiceans was somehow lost, then it was not of God. I know that sounds like begging the question a little bit. Well, it's, it sounds like a cop-out. But we got to believe that if God is going to prepare His scripture for His people, that He's going to protect it and make sure that it does not get lost to antiquity, because He certainly protected 27 books. And then the last thing I want to look at is the Roman persecution, because this played a very important part. Initially, the Christianity was under what's called, the Romans called Religio Licita, or licensed religion, because the Jews were considered a licensed religion. They were allowed to practice. And Christianity was just considered a sect of Judaism, one of the little segments within Judaism. So it was left alone for the most part, at least in the beginning. But there were accusations. Misunderstandings. They used to have what was called love feasts, where people would get together and have these big dinners, and everybody would just be loving on each other. Well, they called it love feasts, and the Romans thought that there was some kind of sexual perversity going on. They heard about baptisms, and they thought that the Christians were drowning people, because the Christians were talking about, being buried in baptism, dead in baptism, that you would die and then resurface alive, and so they assumed that they were drowning people. They heard about the Lord's Supper and thought that they were cannibalizing somebody. They were eating the flesh and blood of somebody. The Christians were meeting in secret, because they were hiding from the Jews. So they thought there was some kind of a weird, cultic things going on. One of the biggest accusations with that group was that Christians were atheists, because they didn't believe in the pagan gods of the Romans, and that they prayed with their eyes closed, so they were considered atheists. Also, Christians were doing damage to the pagan economy. We saw that in the Book of Acts. People were getting saved, no longer worshiping the pagans. The guys selling the idols were going out of business. So they would, they would appeal to their local magistrate and say, "You got to help me out. They're killing my business." So it started sort of growing the animosity. Nero was really the first one to target Augustus, not Augustus, let's take a look here. Claudius. He was the first one sort of to persecute Christians, but only because he was working against the Jews. He was trying to defend against the zealots that were rising up and committing these terrorist acts. So he sort of unwittingly persecuted Christians because he just considered them Jews. Nero was the first. He was insane. He blamed the Christians for everything. You know, there was a saying that went out that he spread around and said, if it doesn't rain, you can blame the Christians. And he is the one that had both Paul and Peter executed. And unfortunately, Paul didn't realize what he was getting into. I mean, his original trip to Rome, he was in jail for about 2 years. He was released, but then under Nero, he was rearrested, and then that was the end of it. So we've got Nero. Then in 69, they had what was called the Year of the Four Emperors. You know, they had Galba, Otho, Vitellius, and Vespasian were all emperor during the year, year 69. Wasn't a lot going on until Vespasian. Vespasian is the one that told his son, Titus, to march against Jerusalem and destroy Jerusalem. Domitian, who was called the Bloodthirsty Beast, performed heavy persecution against Christians. He was the one that put John in Patmos, and he was trying to quash this new movement of Christians. He was the one that called them atheists. After him came Nerva, who liked the persecution, said it's no big deal, let them go, they're fine, they're not harming anybody, and didn't necessarily accept them, but did not continue with the persecution against Christians. And then the last one of that century was Trajan. And I don't want to include him because there was an interesting exchange with a man named Pliny the Lesser, who was a local governor, who did say, I don't know what to do about these Christians. I get these Christians and their people are getting, I'm getting complaints about them and I'm getting, what am I supposed to do with them? And Trajan said this, look, don't hunt them down. If you hear a complaint, if you have a complaint, go to them and ask them if they're a Christian. If they say yes, you ask them two more times. If they say yes both times, then you arrest them. Okay, so if they admit to being Christians three times, then you arrest them. If they want, they can just renounce their Christianity by worshiping our gods, and they'll be let go. And whoever was the complaint about it, you just dismiss them, say, look, they said they just renounced their god, and they're worshiping the pagan god, so leave us alone. And that was sort of Trajan's policy. It was kind of like a don't ask, don't tell kind of thing, where he didn't necessarily hunt them down, but if he found out they were there, he would give them an opportunity to renounce. They renounce, then they're fine. But if they admit it, then they go to jail. And then what we end up finding after this is 200 years, basically, of heavy persecution. Came in waves, up and down. And we're going to see that they're different depending on who the emperor was at the time. That had a different point of view regarding Christians. But this began in a period of about 200 years of persecution of the church, under which the church flourished. And you know, it's one of those things we're going to find that probably the worst thing that could have happened to the church was that it was accepted and became the official religion. Questions? Comments? I gave everybody the syllabus just so you can look at it and get an idea. I mean, the assignments are not for you. The assignments are for those that are taking the course for credit. If you would like, we're reading chapters 1 and 2. I think we had, not that I'm getting one. Make sure I get some. If you want, you can take that's chapters 1 and 2. If you want to read that in the book, Vinny should have the books by the end of the week, so hopefully we'll have those. Questions? All right, thank you.
Next week, they're going to do